welcome to a film I've titled All Roads Lead to Canberra. Canberra is Australia's capital city. The name Canberra derives from the language of the original peoples of that region. It is commonly thought to mean meeting place, although this may not be the case, it's disputed. I've made 3 day trips back and forth from Sydney to Canberra to glean footage each time in order to make this film. On the first trip, a fellow researcher went with me. Please note that my work comes from many different sources as well as my own findings. You will see footage from all 3 trips as well as plenty of other material. Within this film, I will point out some aspects that I suspect the general public in Australia and around the world for that matter has not been aware of. These are aspects that only people within the occult realms are aware of. So I will be showing some things on this film for the first time. I'm going to suggest some things also here and there, and I'm not trying to convince anyone of anything. I'm merely making suggestions, and I have my reasons for making those suggestions. During this film, I'm not going to dwell too much on the meaning behind each symbol as we go along, or each aspect that I bring up. Each of these things is an entire study in itself, so we don't have time to do that. So join me as I point out some parts of a much larger picture. First up, on leaving Sydney, I took the opportunity to film this petrol station logo. It has the colours in there representing the elements, with the Great Pyramid featured. It also has the white for the ether. Now, these are themes that will reoccur during this film. This film of which has a budget that comes solely out of my back pocket. Let's go. On the way to Canberra from Sydney, at the side of the motorway at the M5-M7 interchange, you can see a 3-sided pyramid. The pyramid was constructed by ABI Group, which is part of a larger company called Valimus, and you can see the red fire triangle within their logo. Indeed, the red fire triangle sits atop the 3-sided pyramid. So the red fire triangle would be a male sign, and this is among many other things, and you can see it in the light of the day, in the heat of the sun, so to speak. By night, you can see, you are supposed to be able to see, but the system isn't very good that they put up, but it's supposed to light up blue. So blue for the cool of the night, blue as in the water element. Here in Australia, Aviation Development Australia uses the red fire triangle within their logo. And in the earlier days of Ansett Airlines, when they were operating, they had the red fire triangle within their logo, as does the Spirit of Australia, Qantas Airlines. Many other airlines around the world use the red fire triangle within their logo also. Now, if you look at the Ptolemaic structure of the universe from Claudius Ptolemy, we see in his diagram, we see in the inner ring, we have a representation of the earth and then water. And then in the second ring, we have air. And then on top of that, we have fire. So as part of the symbology for having the red fire triangle on the aeroplanes is that they fly over the air. So they are putting the sort of fire above the air, if you will. Another aspect worth mentioning here is that the 3-sided pyramid perhaps reminds us of the Platonic solid, the tetrahedron, which is related to fire.
We've just got to Canberra, and we're just tuning in to 6:66 a.m.
Oven pretty hot.
Yeah, like about 2:30, 2:40. Yeah, so
they cook quick.
Cook quick.
They on the road trip to Canberra. Canberra's radio station, ABC 666, has a community choir, and here they are performing a flash choir on a chequered floor in a shopping centre. ABC in itself surely carries occult symbology, as does the number 666. Freemasons, among others, incorporate such numbers and symbology into various things. In Freemasonry, the number 36 perhaps pertains to the sun, whilst the number 28 pertains to the moon. Adding both of these numbers together, we get 64, which would equal the number of squares on a chessboard. The magic square of the sun is 6 squares by 6 squares, and the numbers within that square would go from 1 to 36. If you take all of those numbers individually and add them together, you get the number 666, or 666. So, in part, the number 666 refers to the sun, surely. Radio ABC 666 is located in an octagonal building. The use of this shape is quite curious. So just quickly and briefly, the mythical Jesus character supposedly ascended from an octagonal building. According to Muslim tradition, Muhammad ascended from an octagonal building. The octagon very probably relates to mind control, in part, as per Mark Passio's view. The alchemical gold of Fort Knox is either protected or inhibited, depending on what way you look at it, by an octagon. Cage fighters use an octagon. Sydney University has one in the middle of the quadrangle. The War Memorial in Hyde Park, Sydney, incorporates the octagonal shape. The Australian War Memorial in Canberra does too. I'll stop there. In 1911, a competition was put forth for the Plan of Canberra, and on the 23rd of May in 1912, a winner was picked, and that was Walter Burley Griffin, an American architect. Burley Griffin's design went on to influence the city of New Delhi in India, and you can see that with a comparison of Canberra and New Delhi. Now, I have two books here on Canberra. One is Canberra Cosmos by Guy Freeland, and it is an interesting book. But the book I find more interesting of these two books is The Secret Plan of Canberra by Peter Proudfoot. Now, this book by Proudfoot is based on a book by Marion Griffin, Walter Burley Griffin's wife, and she wrote The Magic of America. So we'll have a look inside this book. So within the book here, we have this illustration, and we have the Vesica Pisces in the middle here. One circle, the outer circle here, perhaps represents the spirit, whilst the other circle out here represents matter. So here we have Griffin's street design, and we'll just focus in on this part here. So the new Parliament building is here, the old Parliament building is down here. The new Parliament building was opened on the 9th of May in 1988 by Queen Elizabeth II, and it was designed by Aldo Giugola of Mitchell Giugola Architects. Anyway, so we have the circle here, and within the circle there are two arcs. Now, Griffin originally put these two arcs in the original design, and what Peter Proudfoot here has done is he has made these into full circles to sort of show the Vesica Pisces shapes here. Now, this configuration we can see on the Kaldai Temple in Wylie Park of Sydney. And also within that temple we can see the numerous deities and what is a syncretistic monotheistic religion of the Kaldai.
You can also see this configuration within the Olympic logos. And what I would suggest is that these circles perhaps represent the elements also. So we'll just keep moving along here. Over on this next page here, we can see some various diagrams. And there are, of course, numerous influences here. And we see the name Blavatsky over here, Madame Helena Blavatsky. And so I'll just read from this part here anyway. The triangle played a prominent role in the religious systems of every great nation, for everywhere it represented the three great principles, the spirit, force, and matter. Or, and we'll just turn the page, the active male, passive female, and the correlative principle, which partakes of both and binds the two together. And then it goes on the same tangent there. So there's a lot of information in this book. Here is a map, and we'll just have a closer look at this. Within this map here, we can see the this part here. Now this is Ainslie, Mount Ainslie, and sort of Canberra is based on, it's aligned sort of to the earth, if you will, to these mountain peaks of Ainslie, and then it goes way, way, way back here to Bimbury Peak, which is way back over here. The city of Canberra itself is located just in this part here. There's another axis, and it goes from Black Mountain here across this way, perpendicular to the land axis. So you have the water axis and the land axis. Now these within these axes you get four parts, and these are what can be referred to as quadrata, and they come from a Roman system. Now also we have from here across we have a municipal axis as well that goes across this way. So we'll just keep flowing through. We can see there Chinese geomancy, many influences, crystal iconography. Now this on this illustration here, we're looking across from what is now Anzac Parade here, and then across Lake Burley Griffin, and then up, and then this structure here was Walter Burley Griffin's design for what would be Parliament House, new Parliament House right now. And you can see that it has this ziggurat structure, this stepped pyramid structure. Now, within the new Parliament House, it has a bit of a stepped structure to it also, which was no doubt done to sort of incorporate the design ideas of Burley Griffin into the design of Gergiola in the new Parliament House. So I think that's worth showing, and we'll just keep going through. And it talks about the crystals and crystallization of matter. We'll just go across to this page now, and here we have the Omphalos of Delphi, so this object here. And within here it's talking about the axis mundi, or the caput mundi, which is an axis that sort of goes sort of right through the middle of the planet, if you will. So in this case it would kind of make Canberra the sort of center of the planet, if you will. If you look at a map of Canberra, you can see the various avenues going in there, with Melbourne Avenue and Sydney Avenue, and Hobart Avenue, and so forth, making it the center of the world, if you will, among other things. But we'll just keep going through. These are ideas that are in this book and are part of the planning, no doubt, of Canberra. And it goes into lots of bits and pieces about alignments and stuff. I'll just do a little bit of reading from here. And this is where, this is some writing from Marianne Griffin's book, The Magic of America. And it's basically writing about the influence of Mr. Bragdon on Walter Griffin. So I'll just read from here where it says, "The vegetable kingdom transfers the spirit to matter, mathematics to life. The ether shapes the leaves from circular to triangular. Australia's archangel was the greatest of artists playing with forms. Griffin emulated him in playing with forms. Spirits conceived life in the triangle and the sphere. Goethe sensed this." It's interesting here how there are these references to spirits forming things, if you will, in our realm. So we'll just keep going on. Okay, so I've bookmarked this page. We have a couple of diagrams here, and they refer to the white tiger and the azure dragon, and sort of how this forms a feng shui, sort of a geomancy, if you will. And there's lots of information about it in here, but we'll keep moving on. And here we go, more into the symbolism of the crystal. And once again, there are some illustrations to do with this. Many things in this book to look at, so I'm just giving a bit of a brief rundown, and I think I'll leave it at that. So I'm now in Canberra, and I've just stopped off for a coffee before I get going. I had about 3 hours sleep last night, so that's actually not too bad. The first time I came down here, I was going on no sleep. So this is the local newspaper, the Canberra Times. A few articles there. Let's check the today's date out. Police pushing for lapel cameras. Something about police taser guns there. Here's the local religion here in Australia, the footy. I enjoy a bit of the footy myself. Mount Ainslie, I think this is Mount Ainslie just up here. I'm pretty sure that would be it. Anyway, so newspapers. So this newspaper, the Canberra Times, would relate to Father Time, to Kronos. Now, the New York Times was founded by two members of the Skull and Bones Society of Yale University. And indeed, Times Square in New York perhaps relates to Kronos, to Father Time as well. It's a Saturnian element, if you will. So other newspapers around Australia include newspapers like The Sun and The Mercury, so forth and so forth. Now, the Sydney Morning Herald, for example, in the past I've asked people if they know what the Sydney Morning Herald means, and people don't, you know, they don't even know what it means generally. I'm just wondering what you think this means, Sydney Morning Herald. What does that mean?
To me, it's a daily newspaper.
Yep. Does the actual wording have any meaning?
I honestly haven't thought about it.
So, yeah. Fair enough. Yeah.
I hear the phrase, I think, of newspapers.
Yep.
You know,
yep.
And broadsheet, so yeah. You know.
What does Sydney Morning Herald mean? Do you know what it means?
No.
Not really?
No.
Morning news.
Morning
daily
news.
Daily news.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sydney Morning Herald.
Really, yeah.
It's a job page as well, isn't it? Like, it's well known for the jobs.
Yeah.
Yeah.
the Sydney Morning Herald is basically referring to the Morning Herald of Mercury. As the sun is rising, Mercury, if it's already in the right position in the sky, will shine. Mercury will shine, as will Venus. But Mercury is the messenger god, so the Sydney Morning Herald most likely refers to Mercury. And indeed, we have newspapers around Australia called the Mercury. This all sort of ties in, and you will often find that these newspapers have astrology in all of them. They have the horoscopes in them, rather. Another newspaper is the Guardian, which is in the Guardian is in the UK, and I haven't discussed that before, and I will discuss it today. Down in Adelaide, I believe there is the Guardian Messenger newspaper, and I plan to talk about the Guardian anyway, and Guardians. So we'll just have a look in here in the back, and in this lift out here, I just noticed there would be the horoscopes there, and on this page here, just another logo. I'll point out logos that have the symbols of the elements: water, there, fire, earth, and air. Anyway, we'll carry on. Just before I do, I've pointed out before, the Sydney Morning Herald, for example, imagine if it was called the Sydney Morning Jesus. If it was called the Sydney Morning Jesus, people would certainly take a second look at the paper and go, well, you know, what's this all about, and what's the agenda behind the people who run this newspaper?
Okay, so the coffee was great. Now, I could talk more on newspapers, but we have to move on. As far as symbology goes, it's my opinion that symbology can carry good meanings and nefarious meaning also. Much of the symbology that we're going to see today is Masonic based and the like. As far as Freemasonry goes, I might as well say it now. It's my opinion that within Freemasonry, there are, especially at the top, there are good elements and there are bad, nefarious elements also. Don't jump to conclusions about what I think about symbology, and please make up your own mind and do your own research. Okay, let's go.
So let us really start the journey in Canberra here today. So we're looking down Anzac Parade here towards the Parliament Building, Australia's Parliament Building, and first up we're going to have a look inside the Australian War Memorial right here. So let's go inside.
In the lobby or porch of the Australian War Memorial, we have the Menengate Lions, the lion Leo, representative of the sun. They are holding these shields, and we have the Cross of Lorraine on the shield here. The Cross of Lorraine is an heraldic cross. It perhaps has noble meaning behind it. It is also perhaps used within satanic circles as well. Please don't read too much into what I'm saying. I'm just mentioning this as a possibility. Here we have the other Menengate lion there from Ypres in Belgium. Now we're just going to have a look through into this area through here, into this area here, and we'll have a look at the Eternal Flame, and there we have the Eternal Flame there, and we'll just have a quick look up here, and we're going to see this is the Hall of Memory here, and we're going to have a good look inside that. There's a coin sticking up in the water there just by the Eternal Flame. So the Eternal Flame has alchemical symbolism behind it, no doubt. In this case, we have the water and the flame, water and fire. Now, there was a Greek philosopher of the 6th century named Heraclitus, and it was his opinion that water and fire perhaps represented the human soul, for example. And we'll just move on from that. Up beside that on the walls, we have the gargoyles, and we can see this part here where the water would come out, gargoyles, gargle water, gargoyles. These gargoyles are perhaps representative of the spirit world. That would be my opinion. So there are some more gargoyles there. And there's alchemical symbolism behind them, but I'm not completely sure of what it is. We have Jachin and Boaz there. And just looking through to the new parliament building there, which we will be having a look at later. So within the war memorial, we have various statues, and we have these walls honouring the soldiers of World War I and World War II. We have poppies on here. The poppies are a reminder of blood and sacrifice. They sort of come from the battlefields of northern France and Belgium, and perhaps Turkey as well, Gallipoli. So they remind me of blood trickling down there, blood sacrifice. Just having a look. Okay, so this is the entranceway into the Hall of Memory. Up here we have an octagonal light. Now this perhaps gives us a hint as to the octagonal nature of the Hall of Memory. We have the gates here, and we'll just have a quick look at the symbology of the gates on the way in. And we can see the swan there and other various symbols, and we'll just keep moving through. So we're inside the Hall of Memory here, and we're just going to have a little feel for what is inside. On the floor here we have the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier. So the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier perhaps represents the fornix of the brain. It also perhaps represents the Ark of the Covenant as well. And we have these pillars up here which are representative of the elements. So we'll just have a closer look at these. And we have water, earth, fire and air. And that is the order of those pillars there. And they each have various different construction. We have a beheaded man here. Well, it's one of the statues here. So this is an airman. And above the airman, we have the wyvern. Now the wyvern has almost human qualities to it, as well as sort of a dragon qualities. There is a wyvern lodge in Sydney, a wyvern Masonic lodge in Sydney. And it is my opinion that this figure is representative of the spirit world. And it's sort of feeding, it's almost like it's looking down and, in this case, perhaps feeding off the destruction, although that may not be the case. So up here above this service woman, we have another sort of creature that is perhaps half and half, half human, half horse, the Centaur. The Centaur was a ship, a medical ship, in the Second World War. It got bombed by the Japanese, and so that creature also is perhaps representative of the spirit world. We have the various crosses here, represented in the Hall of Memory, and here are the sort of four. There are four mosaics. Now I suspect that among much other symbology here, that the elements are represented. So just having a quick look at that. We have the sailor here, perhaps representing water, the airman, perhaps representing air, this man here, perhaps representing fire, the soldier, and the female here. Now the female would have to represent either water or earth, so she perhaps represents earth.
Now, just for a couple of minutes, let's position ourselves out of Canberra and here into Hyde Park here in Sydney and have a look at some of the things here that correlate with what we see in Canberra, plus a little bit more. Let's go. Right next to the war memorial here in Hyde Park, we have the Olympic logos here with the plaque, a remnant from the Sydney Olympics 2000. And we have the elements here. We have water, air, earth and fire with the spirit in the middle. So we'll go up to the war memorial here and have a look further. If we walk into the entrance of the Anzac War Memorial here and we look upwards, we can see the pentagram, which perhaps represents the elements earth, water, air and fire, plus the spirit. And we'll just keep walking in here, and we can see the statue by Rainer Hoff, titled Sacrifice. Here within the Anzac Memorial, there is a lot of symbolism. Above, we have 120,000 stars in the dome up here. Now, if you break that down, that is 12. So what do we have 12 of above? Below here, we have a statue created by Freemason Rainer Hoff. And we have what is perhaps the sun, or the black sun, below here. We also have the black sun represented three times around the sides. It's over in here, and it's over here, and we have the regular sun here. Above each of these, in these alcoves, we have the keystone above there. Over here, we have the eternal flame, as we do in all of the war memorials. Now, above, we have what is perhaps a representation of the elements. So up here we have the airmen representing air, whilst over here we have the female representing earth. Over this side we have a man, a soldier with a gun in the line of fire, perhaps representing the element of fire. And if we come around this way and look up, we can see a man from the Navy representing water. The four elements are perhaps represented, I would certainly say. This man here holds a bomb. He doesn't have a shirt on. This is a very masculine, phallic-looking representation up here. An accentuation, if you will, of the male aspect. As part of the symbolism here in Hyde Park, and with this place here in the War Memorial as the centre, we can go out, and if we look down on Hyde Park, we can see that we are in a sun window here, that I'm in the middle of a sun window right now. We can also see what we could liken to the Union Jack, with the St. George and St. Andrew's crosses crossing through it if we look directly down. Now also we have the arms of the compass pointing out here. So we have one going in this direction, and we have another pointing down here. And they would perhaps be 60 degrees apart, or pretty close to it. Now another aspect to the compass here is that the compass has a hinge. And what I would suggest is that the hinge of the compass is represented, one by the lower part here, and then by the upper part as well. Because if you take a compass apart, you have the two parts of the hinge. So you have one part like so, and then you have the other sort of fitting over it like this and hinging around. So I'm suggesting that the hinge of the compass is incorporated into the memorial here. On this side of Hyde Park here, we have what is perhaps the female principal through here. And down this side here, we have what is perhaps the male principal as well. So we'll just have a quick look at those. So here we have a monument that I feel represents the female for the most part. We have the folds here of the vagina, perhaps the labial folds. And on the interior, we perhaps have the interior of the vagina and or the womb. And Here we have a fountain. Here is a shot of it working, giving us the female principal. And then if we go directly opposite through Hyde Park here, we have the obelisk on the other side, representing for the most part the male, of course. So this is that phallic male obelisk here in Hyde Park, sitting within the curved structure here, the female curved surrounding here, with the one step and then two, represented by the outer foliage edge that goes right around. And we have the labia minora, the labia majora. One, two. Now we also have the reflection pool here, reminding us of the above, the heavens above, and us below here. Now we'll move up to this point here and we'll have a quick look at the square that makes for the square and compass here in Hyde Park. We're now directly opposite the war memorial here, and we have what is perhaps the square represented down here. So we have the 90 degree square represented in Hyde Park here. So this makes for the total square and compass that we can see from above.
In addition to Hyde Park, and in Sydney also, we have Obelisk Beach in Middle Head. Now the obelisk is of course the phallic object, and one would expect the female counterpart about also. And we do have that in the waters here. But if we look over here, we have the Middle Head Oval. Funny that. Now you can head down to the beach through this winding path, and on your way you can see the sign, and we can see here that it is a nudity permitted beach, a nudist beach. So I saw a nudist down here on the rock, and it happened to be Queen Elizabeth here on the rock getting what little sun there was, if any. Here is another close-up of Queen Elizabeth. Now across the other side of the beach we had this man here also trying to perhaps get what little sun there was, although I suspect he was perhaps trying to find the obelisk. Let us head back now to the Australian War Memorial in Canberra, where prior to our excursion into Hyde Park and Obelisk Beach, Sydney, we were looking at the mosaics and the possibility, and I would say it's a very strong possibility, that the mosaics incorporate the elements within them. And we have the key, the four pillars. I would say they are a bit of a key to letting us, or hinting to us, that the elements are incorporated into those mosaics. So now let's have a look at the glass windows and the symbology within the beautiful glass windows at the Australian War Memorial. So we have the people up here. We can see that the bottom half of them sort of forms into pillars of society, if you will, people as pillars. We have these various virtues down here, curiosity, devotion, candor, resource, so on and so on. These are perhaps representative of the virtues in Freemasonry. As you sort of walk up the steps, they have virtues for each step. It's Masonic symbology, if you will, covert in this case. So we'll just have a closer look up here. So we're just going to have a look across. We'll just focus for a second on this owl here. So we have the owl up here. The owl perhaps represents knowledge, wisdom, which is a good thing. But it also is perhaps worshipped as Moloch. Here we have another owl. This is in Belconnen in Canberra also. So owls are surely symbolically tied to wisdom. But there is another aspect to this, a dark aspect surely. And we get that through the symbology that is tied to the cremation of care. I'm not going to go into this right now. It's a big subject, and if you don't know about it, what can I say? So we have a pelican up here, and it is feeding the young. It would be feeding the young off its own flesh, a symbol of sacrifice. This is alchemical symbolism. So there is more to that symbolism than that. Here we have an eye, the eye of Ra, perhaps, the Egyptian eye. There is a lot of Egyptian iconography throughout this. So we have measurement of the cosmos throughout the Hall of Memory. So what we're going to have a look at here, just sort of phallic symbology here. So this man is holding this object here, which would perhaps be phallic. Then we have this man here with this rod, phallic. Then we have the woman here. She is holding a chalice. A chalice is receptive, and that is perhaps a female quality, with the soft cloth here, representative perhaps of the female also, receptive, and also perhaps representative of the female sexual anatomy also. We have this man is holding a phallic object, and this man here is also holding a phallic object. We'll just have a look at some more symbology. So here we have the square and compass. This is and here we have the keystone as well, with the archway here. This is overtly Masonic symbolism. Overt Masonic symbolism. Here we have the elements, the water, earth. We would have air and fire represented here. And of course, the Egyptian motif keeps flowing through here. Of course, the symbology in here is said to, you know, sort of tie to various wars and conflicts, including Egypt. So here we have the snake going up the staff, representative perhaps of knowledge in part, with the curious sort of flame-like thing on its head. And we'll just keep going through. We have the eagle, perhaps dovetails as the phoenix. More Egyptian symbology. We have this curious lightning strike, perhaps representative of the electrical nature of our universe. Now, above this man's head, we have these pipes. They are pipes, musical pipes, from the god Pan. So the god Pan is a satyr, and the satyr is representative of Saturn. It's Saturnian, and Pan is a moon that goes around Saturn. And they're wrapped up in the fasci here, and the cross part here perhaps represents the torus. So we have, but we do have some sort of reference here to Saturn, Saturnian symbology, if you will. We have the crown here, and above the crown we have the lion representing the sun, the almighty hero, the sun. Okay, so there's a bit of an overview of the Hall of Memory. Up here we have swans, black swans, and we'll just have a closer look at the black swans. So here are some black swans. This is in Canberra. This is Black Mountain up here, and we have the black swans. They are native to Australia and New Zealand. We have black swan events. Black swan events are known as surprise events, major events, and events that on hindsight one could say, oh well, perhaps we could have expected that. So that's them there, and they are represented in the Hall of Memory. So now we'll just have a closer look at the dome in the Hall of Memory. The dome is where it's situated. If you look at an old map by Walter Burley Griffin, you can see the radiating structure, roads, if you will, coming out from where the Australian War Memorial is. Now, the other thing that Walter Burley Griffin planned to do was he planned to put a casino there. And in a casino you have gambling. And gambling is something that that is tied to the sign of Leo, and the constellation of Leo is tied to the sun. The sun is the sphere that is representative of Leo, the lion. Another aspect to this is that the Australian Armed Forces use the symbol of the rising sun. And one of their motifs is Australians shine under a rising sun, being one of the mottos of the armed forces. So I'm just going to start reading out of this book here, Guy Freeland, Canberra Cosmos, and we will read his thoughts on the symbology within the dome, within the cupola, within the Australian War Memorial. While the rising sun dominates in the windows, if we lift our eyes to the centre of the cupola 26 metres above us, we find not the physical sun, but the spiritual sun. The design of the dome is highly intricate and deeply symbolic. At the zenith is the spiritual sun, with a light gold spiraled centre, which gives way first to an orange spiral band of intense activity, and then a band of gold, from which spring radiating bayonets of gold light which penetrate the corona of orange flames. Now, if we look right up to where the aperture is in the top of the dome, we can see the two Fibonacci spirals there, which is quite interesting, and we can see that symbology. We see it in Melbourne, and we also see it around Canberra as well. So I will just read on. The design is structured around the number 7. The 7 rays tell us that the spiritual sun is the 7-pointed star of the Commonwealth of Australia. Immediately surrounding the Commonwealth star / spiritual sun are the 5 principal stars of the Southern Cross, which appear on the Australian flag. I think it's worth noting that these stars have a dark look to them. The Southern Cross is a constellation where deities go to die in the southern skies, if you will. So that's quite interesting. It's esoterically aligned with death, if you will. So let's keep going on here. From the centre, let the eye now wander to the cornice, which forms a base to the cupola. Moving inwards, we see a band of stylized water lilies and bulrushes. I will suggest that the water lilies and bulrushes here represent earth and water, the elements. Now, that's me saying that. Now, above that, a band of black swans are in flight. Next comes a striped black and red band, followed by an endless rope, symbol of eternity. Finally, there is a wreath of wattle leaves. There is a clear ancient Egyptian influence on the cornice design. The bulrushes and water lilies are reminiscent of the papyrus and lotus emblems of Upper and Lower Egypt and the black swans of Nilotic scenes. The black and red band also suggests the Egyptian black and red land, signifying the rich Nile mud and the desert respectively. The cornice, in short, symbolises the ancient land of Australia and so carries into the hall the message of Leslie Bowles, Corbells, in the courtyard. We haven't looked at that message, but anyway. The wattle wreath is a symbol of mourning, but it also suggests the crown of victory offered to heroes in ancient Rome. So we have Rome and Egypt symbolized here. So carrying on, around the rim of the cupola proper are 7 pairs of hands. The hands symbolize the earth releasing the souls of the fallen, represented as winged sarcophagi marked with the cross of sacrifice, which ascend through the elements towards a spiritual sun. The ascending columns of the sarcophagi, together with the ascending rays of the spiritual sun, which vitalize the earth with their warmth, with their light and warmth, divide the cupola into 14 segments, and that would be 2 × 7. There are 42, which is 6 × 7, there are 42 sarcophagi arranged around the lower rim of the cupola. There are 35, which is 5 × 7, sarcophagi around the spiritual sun, together with the 7 bayonets of light. There are 28, which is 4 times 7, black swans. Now, the 28 black swans perhaps represent the 28 phases of the moon, and in total there are 42 plus 35 sarcophagi represented, which come to a total of 77. So here is a temple resembling the human form. The human that walketh on the ground is below, whereas up in the stars you have another human, Adam Kadmon, among the stars, as above, so below, as per the Hermetic maxim. Here we have the Australian War Memorial floor plan. I'm suggesting that there are two plans in one. We have this part here, which resembles the Solomon's Temple. This particular idea of what Solomon's Temple was, and we have a correlation between the two, and then we also have the church, cross, the church sort of cross design out of that as well. Here we have the Sea of Bronze, so we would have water and bronze and the round shape. Now remember that as we go forth, because you may see that, and I'm not going to point it out. So I've just sort of drawn in the similarities here, Jachin and Boaz, Jachin and Boaz. Now these are the pillars. Now these pillars can perhaps sort of go down this way, if you will, from an upright position to sort of lying down, and they resemble the legs. They can also resemble the testicles, as you will find out soon, perhaps. So we'll keep going. Here we have the Ark of the Covenant, and here we have the Tomb of the Unknown Soldier, and I suggest that this placement and position and all the rest of it is basically coming straight out of here. Here we have another likeliness, and we'll just keep moving on. Once again, another illustration. I noticed this drawing. This is perhaps Adam Kadmon. It may just be an acrobat, but this was in an old basilica, and there you have it there with the stars above, the constellations above, and how they relate to the human form, to Adam Kadmon, if you will, around the zodiac. So a very interesting figure in a church there, in a basilica. Here we have a visitor's map from the Australian War Memorial, and they've nicely gone and separated out what I regard as Solomon's Temple, and this part here would be the church area. Here is a diagram, and this is looking at the sort of classic church design, with a bit of a comparison here of this figure here resembling Jesus. So and then so this shape corresponds with Jesus. Here you can see a church plan, and you can see the nave here. Now I've seen official explanations that say that the nave refers to naval and a vessel and a ship and so forth. Well, that perhaps may be the case as part of the esotericism here, but the nave also surely relates to the navel, because you have the head up here, you have the temple, so to speak, and this part here is the nave, which is the belly. So down here you would perhaps have the sacral region, where the reproductive organs are. Now interestingly, in this particular diagram here, and this is coming from the Chartres Cathedral in France, we have a labyrinth there, the labyrinth. So here is a picture of that labyrinth. Now this labyrinth perhaps refers to the intestines, which are in the abdominal region, but labyrinth, labia, and the so this cord perhaps represents the umbilical cord coming from the from between the labia, so to speak. And we have this maze here. And we have the pews here, which perhaps represent ribs. There's another aspect to this, and we'll go. I'll go into that. Now, in Canberra, we have the labyrinth in Cockington Green Gardens, where they have, so this is a miniature. They also have Stonehenge there. They're both miniature. But it's interesting that we have this symbology in Canberra. So here is St. Foy's Cathedral, and I'm just using this plan for an example. And what I'm suggesting is that, and it was Jordan Maxwell who first pointed this out to me, that we have the penis in the middle here with the testicles here as part of the symbology that's going on here. And then further, we would have the outside here. This would be the womb part. When the male and female bride and groom go up the aisle here, they meet up here, and in a way this is where the where there is a meeting of the sexual parts up here as well. So that's quite interesting, the idea of unity there, and unity on the altar, alteration. So just moving on, another aspect is that within the cathedrals in the rooftops, it almost looks sort of womb-esque in the upper parts of the ceilings. So the church is possibly a womb as well, and a womb is a place where humans perhaps feel safe. It's a sanctuary. Here's a shot in Sydney, and we can see another aspect of the church here. So what I would also suggest is that this part here, so this is the sacral area of the church, for example. So from there we have the upright penis going up, so the phallic steeple. And here we have the vagina, the labia of the vagina at the doors here. And then we have the red doors. Now, one reason that I can certainly think of as to why you would have red doors there is because within the various myths, we have these miraculous births. In the case of Jesus, he was supposedly born of a virgin. Now, a virgin would still have the hymen, and the hymen would certainly break and bleed on the birth of Jesus. If you look at Jesus was also the Lamb of God. It's interesting when you look at Freemasonry, and they have Hiram Abiff, which is perhaps Hiram above, relating again to Aries, the constellation of Aries. Now Hiram Abiff is the son of a widow, so the widow is perhaps a very esoteric way of suggesting also no husband. The Freemasons are very tricky with this symbolism, but the I think you can see what I'm trying to say there with the between the widow and the virgin birth. So similar concepts. So we'll just move along here. There's another close-up of the door with the labia majora and the labia minora. Here is the Presbyterian Church of Australia logo, and you can see the labia there. It's reasonably obvious, and we have the cross in the middle, in the centre, with the burning bush. The burning bush perhaps refers to the fornax of the brain, as per the information of Bill Donohue. The cross represents both male and female. The downward part, the perpendicular part, representing the male, whilst the lateral part here represents the female. And we'll just keep moving along here. So the first time I sort of saw this, I saw this on a Volvo car. Volvo. Now, Volvo in itself certainly refers to the female genitalia. And I saw this on the back of the Volvo, and they had placed it upside down. So you see the it sort of accentuates the penis, so to speak, going through the vagina here. I've done a bit of labelling over here, but we'll just keep moving on. So that is actually the logo from a school in here in Sydney. Some further logos just on the subject of the cross. Here we have the male part here going through the vesica pisces here, and that's the female part there. The curved female and the straight male here. And we have this Boys Brigade logo here with the phallic anchor that goes into the female waters sort of going through there. I'm just adding a bit of extra stuff in here for people to look at. Here we have the Prendeville Catholic Catholic College logo, again with the waters going this way laterally, and the vertical male part here. And so earlier on I showed you that we have the water axis, so there is the water axis there, and then we have the land axis, that is the land axis there. So I'm just sort of superimposing the logo over the water and land axis there, so you can see the male and female part of that. Located right here beside Parliament House, we have the Presbyterian Church of St. Andrew in Canberra, of course. So if we just locate ourselves here, we can see their sign. And even though it is not that clear, they have the church with the steeple within the Vesica Pisces here. So it's a very elegant combination, I think, of the Vesica Pisces and the church, the phallic church steeple within, in this case.